Canada reads, and so does Lennoxville. My name is Christian Collins. I'm the library coordinator, and I'm going to just say a few brief words before I turn it over to our fearless MC, Stephanie Brown. I want to start with a land acknowledgement. We acknowledge as we gather here tonight that we are on the unceded territory of the Wabanaki people here at the confluence of the Massawippi and the St. Francis Rivers. We honor their elders, past, present, and future. We acknowledge that some part of our own success rests on a history of violence towards Indigenous people and colonization of their lands. We pledge to work towards a true and lasting reconciliation. I don't know if you have noticed on your tables, if you're sitting at a table or in the chairs, there's sheets of paper. This is a new thing this year, but I want to draw your attention to it. The theme of Canada Reads this year is the one book to carry us forward. And in these slightly troubled times, I guess we thought that it was kind of a nice thing to do to make that a collective reflection on what is the thing that will carry us forward. So you'll see the sheets of paper on your tables, and you've got a nice array of colored pencils. If you could, if you're moved to and it speaks to you, if you want to just make a note, it can be informal, it can be a doodle, it can be anything you're inspired to do, but something about what carries you forward. At the end of the night, we'll gather them up and we'll try to be sharing them in a creative way in the next few weeks. So please help us out by doing that. And the last thing before I turn it over, I just, by a show of hands, how many of you are aware that the Lennoxville Library is a not-for-profit organization that depends on the support of the community to do everything it does? Okay, you guys are the library faithful right here. But I just want to bring it to your attention that really we rely on the city of Sherbrooke for a good part of our funding. We act in lieu of a public library here in Lennoxville, but we are a private not-for-profit, so the city gives us funding to allow us to keep our doors open, to provide core library services. Everything above and beyond that really comes from community support. So if you like what we do and you enjoy the library and you're moved and able to donate a little bit, there is a donation jar at the front. And coincidentally or not, it's manned by our treasurer. So that's perfect. And if you'd like to make a donation, that's great. But we're completely committed to maintaining free library services. So this is a free event. Don't feel any obligation. If anyone didn't get a ballot, the ballots are in the entrance, again, right next to the donation jar, you will be voting, so just in case you came in another way or something and you didn't get a ballot, if you want to just make sure you get one before the voting. And that's all I have to say, but I will turn it over to Stephanie Brown. Thank you all for being here.
Good evening, everyone, and I thank you for all for coming this evening, attending. The way it's going to run is I'm going to introduce all our presenters and which book they will be presenting. As you can see on the screen up here, the books are projected. After I've introduced them, we're going to start with alphabetically. So we're going to be, and they're also seated in the order in which they will be speaking to their books. After which, there will be a prize drawing. There are door prizes. You have to be present in order to win. So you received a ticket when you came in. So pay attention. There will be some announcements throughout the evening for door prizes. Okay. So here we go. Welcome, everyone. So I'm very pleased to once again be hosting Canada Reads, and so does Lennoxville. I'm also very pleased to introduce you to our champions, our book champions this year. Tanya Bellermeer-Allett. So Tanya Bellermeer-Allett is the author of the critically acclaimed Peacekeeper's Daughter, a Middle East memoir, which was published in 2021, and a poetry collection, Chaos Theories of Goodness, published by Shoreline Press in 2022. She has taught English literature at Champlain College, Lennoxville for 18 years. Tanya holds an MA in English literature from McGill University and an MFA in creative writing from UBC. She lives in North Hatley, and she will be defending Bad Cree. Morris J.O. Crossfield is a fifth generation townshipper who worked for nearly 15 years as a reporter at the Sherbrooke Record. His eclectic career path has included a stint as editor-in-chief at Harrow Smith. He has worked as a translator and a professional writer. He has some mystery books that have been published set in the western part of the Eastern Townships. He has various occupations ranging from mechanic, organic gardener, to truck driver. He lives in West Brom with his wife, musician Sarah Biggs, and a collection of dogs and cats. And he will be championing the future. Yes. Next, Elvina Koi, Malaysian-Chinese, has called the Eastern Townships home for his last 16 years. She teaches English literature at Champlain College, and Elvina will be she'll be defending, she'll be speaking to. Shut up, you're pretty. Next, we have Bryan LaPrise. Bryan is an avid reader and writer and strives to promote the arts at his school. He started and runs the student newspaper at Alexander Galt. His writing received a nonfiction award at last year's Townshipers Young Voices, with other pieces of his being published in The Point, The Record, The Townships Sun, and the newspaper he began, The Piper Post. Bryan will be championing Meet Me at the Lake. And Marie Molliner, trilingual, raised in Sherbrooke, Quebec. Marie returned to the townships during the pandemic after four decades of work in Toronto's legal and cultural sectors. She retired early to care for the love of her life and is working on an illustrated novel, Defying the Dictator, that is Dementia, Diaries of an Accidental Caregiver. In her spare time, she pounds clay and volunteers as an assistant editor for the Township Sun. Her book is Denison Avenue. All right, yes. Yes, you have to turn on the mic. This is Ron. Ron is our treasurer at library board. And he will be doing the drawing.
And tonight, I'm the door prize guy. I've got four things to point out to you. One is there's going to be door prizes throughout the evening. So keep your ticket ready. We're going to do three prize draws and then the final at the end. Second is that all the prizes are on the table at the back. So when I call your number out, just go to the back and choose the prize you want from the table there. Number three is don't give your ticket away. Hang on to it, because the grand prize at the end is surprisingly two grand prizes. Each of them is a set of all five books signed by the authors. We're going to give two of them away tonight, five to one person and five to another. And the last thing is, I'm sorry that those who are online, the planning committee decided this is going to be door prizes. You got to come through the door to get a prize. So we're not doing draws online this year as you've done in the past. And so we're going to do a bunch of draws each time to make sure we get all the prizes gone. So we're going to then begin with the first number. I'm going to do the last four numbers only. 7422. 7422.
7422.
Go get your prize.
Get your prize.
The table at the back.
Woohoo! Yay!
The next one. 7469. 7469.
7469.
Don't get your prize in the back.
Woo!
7418. 7418.
7418.
7418. Oh, go get your prize in the back. Hang on to your ticket. Don't give it away. 7408. 7408.
7408.
There you go. Go claim your prize. 7410. 7410. Oh, there you go. Good for you.
Yeah.
7432. 7432.
Ooh. We've had all sorts of prizes donated by the CBC. There's tote bags.
Go get it. And the last one at this point in time is 7451.
7451. There's socks, there's umbrellas or parasol, parapluie, it's up to you. Deck of cards from the city of Sherbrooke, don't know what that's telling us. But.
So we want to say a special thank you to CBC and to the city of Sherbrooke for all our prizes. So let's give them applause to CBC and city of Sherbrooke. Thank you. I'll be back again in 25 minutes.
Yay! Thank you, Ron. Okay, now, what we've all come here tonight to hear is about the books. So we are going to begin with Bad Cree. Oh, Tanya.
Hi, everyone. Bad Cree is a novel written by Jessica Johns, who's a member of the Sucker Creek First Nation in Alberta. As a non-Indigenous person, I recognize that I'm actually poorly qualified to speak about this book, since the Cree world is one that I don't begin to understand or know. How then can I determine what it is to be a good Cree or a bad Cree, as the novel's title suggests? But having said that, one of the things I love about this book is the hospitality it affords to readers like me. It's an invitation to draw near, even enter into the Cree world, and have an intimate experience of one young woman's female kinship circle. In case you haven't yet read Bad Cree, let me tell you a bit what it's about. Bad Cree blurs the boundaries between the dream world and the real world. Mackenzie is a millennial Cree woman living in Vancouver. The book opens with a series of nightmares where Mackenzie brings things back from her dreams. She feels haunted by her negative memories, and she's stalked by crows. In an effort to piece together what is happening to her, she travels back home to the prairies. There, she has to face her estranged family, her parents, sister, cousins, and aunties. 2 years earlier, when her sister died suddenly, Mackenzie had chosen not to go home for her funeral. She is haunted by that decision and feels that she's let her family down. This is a horror story with nightmares, a weedigo, and a haunting. But at its heart, it's about an emotional haunting. Mackenzie, the main character, has to face what is deeply hurting her. She has to go back home to face those demons. What kind of book is it? Bad Cree is in the genre of speculative fiction, but its main themes are emotional horror, trauma, and kinship. It explores big feelings, grief, joy, happiness, and family love. Set on Treaty 8 territory, it's also a book about colonialism, the extraction of oil from the land, and the devastated landscape left behind by the oil companies. It gives the reader an intimate portrait of the kinship lines between three generations of Cree women: Mackenzie, her sisters and cousins, her aunties and mother, and her kokum, her maternal grandmother, who has passed away, but is still very real and present to Mackenzie. This is a book about finding your place in family, in community, and on the land. The title haunted me as I read. What makes a bad Cree as opposed to a good Cree? Who gets to decide? What is the badness exactly, and what do we do with it? When does the bad win out? In some ways, the answers to these questions aren't available to me because I'm not part of the Cree community. I was reminded of this when I came to a new chapter with its title in Cree, undecipherable to me. I was aware that I was an outsider peering into this world, yet the novel invites us to peer, to question, to participate. Bad Cree is a book to carry us forward. Gaining a deeper understanding of the Cree people helps the reader to step away from othering while deeply appreciating the unique aspects of this people group. It's a propulsive novel, very hospitable to the reader. And in the end, love wins. There isn't a big red bow ending, but there's resolution. The nightmares end. There's a sense of forward movement with stronger family ties, true reconciliation, and literary citizenship. Thank you.
Thank you, Tanya. You've brought up a lot of key themes that we're going to revisit when we have the discussion portion of the evening. Thank you so much. Next. Next, Morris. Morris is going to be talking about the future for us.
Yes, the future.
He is.
It's all about the future. The future is written by Catherine Leroux and was translated from French by Susan Uriou. And at the outset, I'd have to say that it's a beautiful translation. I mean, I've worked as a writer and as a translator, and I couldn't go there. It's very poetic. It's a beautiful piece of literature. The future is Catherine LaRue's alternate history of Detroit. It's in which the city was never surrendered to the Americans. It's a French-speaking Canadian city, but it still has many of the problems that we've seen plague Detroit in recent years. Pollution, poverty, the legacies of racism and colonialism. In this alternate future, Fort Detroit, as it's known, society is broken down even further. There's little to be had in terms of police or fire protection, and city services like water and sewage regularly break down. Sometimes entire neighborhoods will just catch fire and burn to the ground. And yet, you know, destroyed buildings such as the city's leaning Tour de Lille, or even neighborhood houses, they'll slowly and mysteriously regenerate themselves. There are magical elements, never clearly explained, that tap into your imagination. And that, to me, is where some of the most profound aspects of storytelling take place. The main character, Gloria, comes to Fort Detroit following the murder of her estranged daughter, Judith, and the disappearance of her granddaughters. She wants to find her grandchildren and the truth of what happened to her daughter. Nearly destroyed by grief, she slowly builds bonds with neighbors and begins to learn of the resilience that keeps them going, despite the harsh realities of their existence. They grow food in abandoned lots, gather necessities from the devastated environment around them, and they comfort each other in times of loss. Gloria also discovers a group of the city's children who live in the nearby Parc Rouge Ravine. Runaways, or perhaps abandoned or orphaned by their parents, these kids have established their own society, complete with its own rules and hierarchies, all based on the greater common good. In short, when these children are abandoned by society, they create a society of their own. Kind of like Lord of the Flies, but far more humane and compassionate. This, to me, is what makes the future a compelling book to move us forward. At its core, this is a book about community. Society may have collapsed, but community endures. Community can mean many things, from neighbors helping neighbors to children supporting each other when adults can't or won't. Much like the buildings regenerating themselves, if a community breaks down, another form of bonding between people moves in to take its place. In this age of anxiety and insecurity, the future is a reminder that in grim times, we don't have to go it alone. Indeed, those darkest of times are when we need to reach out, to build bonds, to serve others, and to receive support in return. We don't control much in this life. The one thing we all have a measure of control over is hope. Hope for a kinder future in which people help each other in spite of the challenges we face. Hope for better times, even when the world around us seems hopeless. Indeed, the absence of hope, like the absence of community, ultimately leads to the end of humanity. In spite of this dystopian backdrop, Future is ultimately a hopeful work, providing readers with plenty to think about and a vision for a way forward. It may seem like the end of society, but in that ending are numerous small beginnings. We are more resilient than we can imagine, and more resilient collectively than alone. The future is a reminder of those simple, life-sustaining facts. Thanks.
Thank you, Morris. I'm very pleased that you brought up the magical element of this book. That, yeah, so we'll come back to that in the discussion, at the discussion portion as well. Elvina. Elvina will be speaking about Shut Up, You're Pretty.
Thank you. Tia Mutungi's Shut Up, You're Pretty is a collection of short stories that are interconnected to form a novella. We are introduced to Lolly, a young Congolese immigrant who has come to Canada with her mother and her brother to reunite with her father. At a very young age, Lolly and her family moved to a neighborhood in Scarborough, Ontario, called Galloway. And from all accounts, Galloway appears to be a kind of a slummy neighborhood. And it is inhabited chiefly by immigrants. It's subsidized government housing. And at the same time, it's, of course, plagued with all sorts of socioeconomic and cultural issues. You name it. There's absentee parents, dysfunctional families, violence, depression, addiction problems, and the exploitation and commodification of sexuality. Trauma is an everyday occurrence in this book. And when I say trauma, I don't mean trauma with a capital T, those kind of singular events that you can point to and you can blame for having changed your life and having had a big impact on your life. Because there also exists micro-trauma, the kind of like little acts of microaggressions, the insults, the put-downs, all the negativity that seems to be negligible, seems to be insignificant, easy to dismiss and overlook, but ultimately build up and accumulate to the extent that it shapes your worldview, it shapes who you are, and it eats away at you. And so in this coming of age narrative, we follow Lolly as she grows up and she tries to understand who she is. She's questioning aspects of her identity, having to do with her gender, her sexuality, her skin color, her social status, the very questions that we ourselves have about our own identity. And we also follow her on her journey as she interacts and tries to navigate through relationships with the people within her community and without it, her family, her friends, her lovers, and members of the community at large. The book is filled with a lot of harsh realities, so it might be a little difficult for some readers to go through. But what really impresses me about Mutungi's work is not so much what she shows us, not so much the content of her book, but how she does it. Her language is poetic. There's a rhythm, there's a cadence. It is Hemingway-esque in its minimalism, in its brevity, and she shows us the tip of the iceberg, but allows us ample space to sort of discover what lies hidden below the surface. And what is truly remarkable is, I think, her usage of defamiliarization. Defamiliarization is a technique much discussed by 20th century Russian formalists. It was coined by Viktor Shklovsky, and basically defamiliarization is when poetic language is used to take the everyday, the very ordinary, and to make it strange, to make it unfamiliar, so that we look at it anew. We don't just recognize it. We look at it with fresh perspective, and we're forced to engage with it again. And that is what she does extremely well in her book. And for something that is only about 120 pages of printed text, it's so thin, it's so small, but it arrests a reader's attention and it forces us to engage with the material. And that, to me, is what makes this book truly special. Thank you.
There's a lot going on in that book. It's, you're right. It's short, but it's very complex. I really like what you brought up about the language, the poetry of it. And this is a theme that runs through all the books as well. So again, when we get to the discussion room. Next, we have Bryan. Bryan will be speaking of Meet Me at the Lake, I believe.
Meet Me at the Lake by Carly Fortune is the first time a book of its genre has been shortlisted for Canada Reads. While it is a romance book and has many common tropes, it is so much more than that. Like any English teacher will tell you, every story has a message, and this story is no exception. There are so many lessons that can be pulled from the novel, all of which can enlighten us about how to view the future and what carries us forward. The story follows Fern Brookbanks, who spent her whole childhood raised by her mother at the family's resort. And yes, because many of you are probably wondering, she is named after the plant. The novel is written using a dual timeline perspective, half of the chapters taking place 10 years ago, and half of them taking place in the present time. Fern's mother, Maggie, took over the resort from her parents, and she had the expectation that her daughter would do the same. 10 years ago, Fern had different dreams for herself. She planned to leave the city, but was scared to break her mother's heart. She convinced her that the best step forward was to study management at the University of Toronto, giving Fern her much-desired freedom. Over the years of being in the city, Fern begins to work at a local coffee shop. She dreamed of opening her own a few blocks down from her apartment, but the plan felt impossible. At the start of the 10 years ago chapters, a week before she's scheduled to move back at the resort, she meets Will. He's back in his hometown, visiting his dad for a short visit. Will gets the opportunity to paint a mural at the coffee shop Fern works at, leading to them meeting. Fern, who wanted to make the most of Toronto while she was still there, accepts Will's offer to give her a tour of his beloved hometown. Spending the day becoming better acquainted with the city and each other, they spend time discussing one another's hopes for the future and plan to meet again in 1 year. Both Will and Fern are currently involved in relationships back home, but they both felt the undeniable connection between them. Will was going to be back in the area the following year, and they decided to meet at the resort. Following her day with Will, Fern built up the courage to tell her mother that she didn't want to work at the resort, instead wanting to stay in Toronto. She spent the following years moving up the ranks at the local coffee shop she'd been working at. Back to the present, Fern's mother is recently involved in a car crash. She leaves the Muskoka Lakeside Resort to Fern, who is now 32 years old and must make an impossible decision: abandon her family's resort, her mom's legacy, or follow her own dreams with the money she would make from selling. Who else would show up at the resort but the Will Baxter from the magical day Fern had 10 years ago? Only it's the first time she's seen him since then, because Will never showed up to the reunion. Fern, while having management experience, isn't capable of making the necessary decisions and plans that would follow suit, whether she sells or keeps the resort. Will is willing to help, now a suit and tie office worker, far different from the artist he was all those years ago. She doesn't fully trust him, especially after he ditched Fern at their promised reunion. It's clear to Fern that he's hiding something, and she wants to find out what. To quote the back cover, 10 years ago, Will Baxter rescued Fern. Can she do the same for him now? The novel deals with many important themes. A major component of the novel is mental health and how one deals with grief. Death and loss are a part of life, and everyone must face them at some point. Seeing Fern go through the different stages of grief can be reassuring, showing that there is light at the end of the tunnel and the burden won't be felt forever. One of the important themes that the book deals with is the hunt to find what makes you happy and what you want to do with your life, which is possibly one of the hardest questions one has to answer. Curly Fortune also included the idea that you can change your mind about what you want to do as well. Will says to Fern, we're not the same people we were at 22. It's okay to want different things. One of the reasons I like this book is that Curly Fortune had the perfect balance of writing about the real-life experiences we can all learn from and having an entertaining, great read. Meet Me at the Lake is a perfect summer read, but can also be enjoyed year-round as we wait for warmer months. The author skillfully immerses the reader into her book through vivid character descriptions, setting descriptions of the calm lakeside resort. It's easy to imagine you're there, experiencing the beautiful sunsets and lakeside air. Thank you.
Thank you, Bryan. Marie is going to be talking about Denison Avenue.
So let me start by asking, who in this room has actually read Denison Avenue? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. Who in this room has been to Toronto's Chinatown? Way more. Okay. And who in this room knows someone who has been hit by a car and died? So a lot of people in this room can relate to this book. This book is very complicated. It's a jewel box of a book. There are two authors. One is an illustrator, and the illustrations are one third of the book in the back, and they're gorgeous. They're before and after places in Toronto's Chinatown primarily. And the front of the book is weaving stories that reflect the backstories about love, loss, and grief. And I really wanted to read this book because I spent 40 years in Toronto, and I would go by the main intersection where Chosum, the primary character in the book, where her husband got hit by a hit-and-run driver who was not found and died shortly thereafter. I would go by there twice a day at least for 40 years on my way to work with the true love of my life. And it's a story about love. It's an incredibly beautiful story about the love of two people. It's characterized in all of the reviews as a story about two elderly Chinese people. Yes, they are from China, and yes, they are elderly in this part of the story, but it could be about any of us. There are so many moments where the author uses voices in two different ways. She'll have her voice and his voice on two sides of the page. In some pages, she has one or two words. So there's prose, there's poetry, and then there's the illustrations, which I had a chance to talk to the illustrator, and I said, you know, where did the story come from in terms of the illustrations? They worked side by side, but they didn't try to weave the story together. So when you see these incredible detailed illustrations, they're all done by hand. He sat in his apartment during the pandemic, he told me, and drew most of these pictures, having to rely on archival images. And then when you ask, I asked the author, you know, where did the story come from? And when you hear her interview, she talks about her own family, Popo being a Chinese word for grandparent, and how she could see the story of these two characters weaving through her own life. So I asked myself, what is it about this book that doesn't carry me forward? On every single page, there is a jewel of a word, and the words, I started to log them, and there were words that were worth savoring at every single stage of my reading, and I had 100 words, which obviously I will not read to you here. But what Chosum does to recover from this traumatic death of her husband is she takes a friend's advice, and what carries her forward are the friendships that she builds, that she relies on from before. These were very well-respected elders in their community, and so the death of her husband involves people who do and don't know he died, and how she navigates the spaces and the alleys of the city around a neighborhood where she decides she's going to become a bottle and can lady. She pulls that grocery cart and fills it with cans and bottles because her friend said, you gotta get out, girl. You gotta do something every day. This is great exercise. You'll get to see how people live. You'll see places you've never seen, and you'll make some cash. She's a single widow. There are no children in this story. And she knows she has a piece of property, Denison Avenue, that's worth millions of dollars, but she's not gonna sell it because that's all she has. So I'm going to read you some of the words that I found were the ones that really carried me forward, and I'm going to tell you how often they are in the book. And maybe you can reflect on your own words. The words, I'll give you the top three words. There are 52 references to the word breath or breathing. There are 18 references to food, the word food. The whole book has food on every single page. So if food doesn't carry you forward, I don't know what you're doing. And there are 12 references to different friendships. So this book is just a complex narrative of friendship, food, and breathing through your day to get through it. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, everyone. Now, Ron, I believe we have some more prizes. Is that true?
We do.
Can I just apologize to
Marie?
Yes,
we got lots more prizes to go, so we're going to call out 7 more numbers. Have your tickets ready to look at? I'll call the last 4 numbers only. 7472. 7472.
7472.
Go to the back table.
Go to the back table.
7421.
7421.
Oh, that's me.
Oh. Well, go to the back table, Tanya.
7428.
I didn't take a ticket.
7428.
7428.
Going once, going twice.
Too late.
7466.
7466. How is this possible that they're not with these tickets?
Oh. 7468.
Oh.
There you go.
7468. Jim.
7471. 7471. Oh, there you go. Oh,
yes.
Close. 7453. 7453. There you go. Thank you very much. I'll be back again in half an hour.
I was supposed to be prepping my questions, and that time I just got so wrapped up in the numbers. I have notes here, too. Okay, so one of the things that every single one of you mentioned was the idea of grief in some respect. Many of you spoke to the idea of the grief being what carries you forward, or working through the grief, going through the stages of grief, I believe, is what was Bryan said. Alvina talked about the traumas, the micro-traumas, that sort of thing. All of the books have some element of grief. How do you feel that, how does the overriding theme of grief and loss, I know that you touched on this a little bit in your presentations, but I'd just like to revisit it a bit. How does this carry us forward? And do the main characters truly work through the grief in the time frame of the books, or do they just begin to do so? And what can it teach us as readers, how we might process some of our own grief or complicated grief? It's something that we all go through, but do these books bring us a way, a means to immerse ourselves in them that help us go through grief, that carry us through it? So my question, I guess, is how does the overriding theme really truly play out, the idea of loss play out in each of your books, just a little bit more concretely than what you touched on in your presentations? And do the main characters really work through the process of their grief, or not? in the time that we spend with them. Where shall we begin? Any volunteers? Or shall I say? Bryan, you mentioned stages of grief. So what do you think?
Well, the book starts off, and Fern, I think it was, it's been about 2 weeks since the accident, and she's back where she grew up, where, you know, she lived with her mom when she was younger. And she just is revisiting all of these memories, and it's really hard for her. And she starts over the course of the book as she decides what she wants to do with the resort. She sort of accepts not necessarily the death, but she starts to go through her grief. And towards the end, it's not as bad. For sure, there's still stuff there. But it's not as big of a part of the book anymore.
Mm-hmm.
So the grief is definitely a big component of the book, but she does learn to go through it and has different ways that she does so. But also, you know, reflecting on all those memories is really something that helps her deal with it.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Tanya, how do you see grief playing out in Bad Cree in a little bit more detail than you ventured at the beginning of the evening?
Well, Mackenzie, the main character, is plagued by not only grief about her sister's death, but especially guilt over her decision not to go back home for her sister's funeral. So she lives in Vancouver, and she stays in the city when her sister passes away very suddenly. So when she decides to go back to the prairies to figure out what's going on with her nightmares, she has to face her grief head on, as well as her guilt. It's a twin grief, because she's grieving her sister's death, but also her kokum, her grandmother's death. And I would say she does find quite a measure of resolution in that she experiences forgiveness from her mother, from her other sister, her cousins, her aunts. And she also, she has a kind of a visitation of her grandmother, because magic or... I wouldn't call that magic, just communion with the ancestors is a big part of the book. So I would say there is resolution there with the grief, even though it's not completely gone. But
she forgives herself in some respects, would you say?
Okay.
Morris? How does Gloria deal with all of that complex and complicated grief in this book? It's a hopeful book, by the way.
Yes. But the book starts off, Gloria, her daughter has been murdered, and she's become estranged from her daughter. And so upon the news of her daughter's murder and the disappearance of her grandchildren, she comes to Fort Detroit, and she's just destroyed. I mean, her daughter had gone down the road of addiction and various things, and they had become estranged, and there's a lot of guilt for allowing that estrangement to happen. And it's actually the death of a neighbor's father. He gets hit by a bus. I think it's a bus. It's a bus. And
run.
And the two of them kind of end up bonding over this. And from that, at the beginning of the book, she's really isolated. Mm-hmm. She doesn't know anyone. And this event really gets her into the community. And they get her out, and she starts working within the community and establishing bonds and friendship and working her way into the community.
Yeah.
And I just think it's a beautiful thing.
You mentioned regrowth, though, when you were speaking. Do you feel like there's some sort of aspect that in, like, the literal idea of the community gardens? Or is it something to do with the... from grief the regrowth begins, from the ashes of the houses?
Yeah, I think there would be, there is definitely an element of that. Like I say, the magic is never sort of defined,
no,
per se.
And much like in Bad Cree, in Tanya's book as well.
So. Yeah, yeah, but like I say, when one thing ends, new things begin. And sometimes even though that terrible thing that happened is so devastating, there's, from that emerges a way forward.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Elvina, I found the book really difficult, but also at the same time, as you said, really beautiful in some places, in some spaces. I just want to look at my notes here. This idea of this defamiliarization that you mentioned, mm-hmm. you know, this pushing us to look at something in a renewed way, I do see that in the book, but I'm not sure that she fully deals with the death of her father, but then again, I'm not really sure that that's what she's really grieving in this book. So how do you see things now?
I don't think she grieves for her father at all. And no. That is one of the problematic things,
yes.
because our expectation would be that you would grieve for a parent.
Mm-hmm.
But she doesn't really have a relationship with her father because, you know, there's one chapter in the book where she arrives and her father takes her on this train ride,
yeah.
and they're supposed to be bonding. But inside, she has other things that she's considering and thinking about. The very fact whether she has even eaten that day was something more present to her
mm-hmm.
than a father who, even when physically close, is psychologically distant.
Yeah.
So at one point in the book, she finally admits that she doesn't feel sad over the father's death. Spoiler alert there.
There's a lot going on in that book. So to know that, it's...
But that's where I think the defamiliarization comes in. She grieves other sorts of losses of connections. For instance, her friend Jolie, who has grown up with her, who's strangely intimate with her, who has shaped so much of her childhood, and who suddenly disappears. And that loss causes her so much more pain than the loss of her father. And our expectation would be that your father would be more important than a childhood friend. But considering how these relationships are, mm-hmm. the relationship between the parent and child versus the female homosocial bonding that she has with Jolie, it just because your blood doesn't mean that you're going to grieve for that person.
Mm-hmm.
But one of my favorite chapters in this book is actually one that addresses a community coming together. And it's one story about Galloway and about the community that focuses on the community of Galloway rather than focusing on Lolly and what is going on in, you know, her internal life and her dealings with the world. And the story, This Is Only Temporary, starts with this line. After Darnell was beaten to death at the intersection of Galloway and Lawrence, everybody kept their doors unlocked, wide open. And that's an example of defamiliarization, because if you're a true crime junkie like I am, you know, you can hear the Keith Morrison voice behind from Dateline going, you know, it was a quiet suburban neighborhood where children play in the yards and everybody left their doors unlocked until the very bad thing happened, right? But this is the reverse.
The reverse, yeah.
Something violent happens and instead the community's doors become unlocked. They're held wide open. And you don't get an answer to that. Instead, you get a huge paragraph about the media portrayal and the media message about this death. And then it is only later when you go into the community that you realize that the community comes together to welcome one another in their, you know, shared grief,
mm-hmm.
in their communal feeling.
Mm-hmm.
And it turns everything on your head, everything that you would expect. And it is in this same story where there's this perhaps message about how to deal with the horrors of our life, where we have a description of Mrs. Broomfield. Mrs. Broomfield didn't charge me for doing my hair either, mainly because I helped with groceries and cleaned when she was getting her nails done with her girlfriends. But I think it was an incentive to get me to come back. In Galloway, Mrs. Broomfield was legend for witnessing the Rwandan genocide. Her attitude, so much positivity and optimism, like, "This is a war, child. It's not going to last." I like to apply that to everything else. This world is a war. This neighborhood is a war. This street, this house, this body, this person, this feeling, this war. Mm-hmm. And so all this is temporary because in life, the only thing that is constant is change. I mean, that old saying, right?
Yeah.
Nothing is permanent except for death and taxes.
There you go.
So here, she tries to apply that to all her experiences. Yeah. No matter how harsh, no matter how traumatic and down she is.
Yeah.
And it can be a huge thing or it can be a small thing. And it's only temporary.
Yeah, so you mentioned community, much as like Morris mentioned community and Tanya as well. And Marie, when you were talking about it, she goes out into her community. She walks it. You said navigate. You used the term navigate. She physically navigates the streets, but she's navigating her grief at the same time. And she finds a sense in the community. Is that kind of how you were, that's how I understood what you said about this book I've yet to read, but do want to read.
So Wong Cho-sum has made the decision that she's a little embarrassed about to become a bottle and can lady.
Mm.
But as she navigates the alleys in the neighborhood, in streets she has never been on at times because she's following her friend, she learns new things about this community where she's lived for decades. And part of her putting her foot forward every day is the way she navigates her grief. And at the same time, and I don't want to pay short shrift to the illustrations,
no,
because
no, they're beautiful.
They are, I actually brought them, I'll pass this around. They are part of the grieving process for the book and for the city and for all of us who've ever lived in a place where things have changed. So North Hatley is where I live now and things have changed. And so these images here, I don't know how well you can see them, but on the far top right, you have what are clearly a Chinese pagoda structure, and below it, you can't tell what it is probably, but I'll tell you that that beautiful Chinese pagoda building was put up in 1976 and torn down in 1986 because of some shady dealings, and it was replaced by a white formica building that is still there, that is a Super 8 hotel, since closed. Huge grief in the book about how that happened. Wow. On the far right, Honest Ed's. How many people know what Honest Ed's is? Honest Ed's is what Le Bon Marché was to Sherbrooke.
Yeah.
Probably about 50 times bigger.
Yes.
A Walmart came in 2013, and Honest Ed sold it, and this block of a store, which is all these tiny little warrens of houses that had little tunnels connecting them, and he put this big placard that said Honest Ed's around it.
Yeah.
And when you're reading the story, all the immigrants, pretty well anyone in Toronto, because it's right at the corner of Bathurst and Bloor, will know where Honest Ed's was. When I say Honest Ed's was, it kind of puts a gulp in my throat, because that's a huge loss, a huge amount of grief for a community, because Honest Ed's would give away free turkeys at Christmas. Cho-sum talks about that. Honest Ed's would have a birthday party for himself and give out free food. He was a community unto himself.
He was.
So absolutely an incredible amount of grief. But Cho-sum manages her grief quite differently. Mm-hmm. It's a quiet grief. And I just wanted to read the moment she returns home from the hospital after she's made the decision to take her husband off life support.
Okay.
And I think that anyone who has lost someone and had to leave them in a hospital and has come home to a house that is empty will be able to relate to this. A train.
We have the mournful train cry in the back.
Wow, that's beautiful. Okay.
Timing's impeccable.
Oh, I think I lost my page.
You can come back to it.
I will come back to it. Thank you.
Cool. All right. So thank you so much for that. So the writing of these books, poetic, lyrical. I said a lot about that with Elvina's. Bryan said, you said it was a fun read, but there's a lot going on even though it's like a summer read. Okay, so what do you mean by summer read? Maybe we know, but like, how do you see that?
Well, the setting definitely plays a big role in that. It's set in the middle of the summer by the lake.
Muskoka. Yeah.
Northern Muskoka, and it's just a resort where vacations happen. So it's very easy to imagine you're there and experiencing, let's say, the wind, the sun, all of the things that we experience in summer. So it can definitely put us in the mood and make the read more enjoyable.
Yeah, I liked what you were talking about, that you went straight to the idea of the setting, because setting, the sense of place in all these books, Marie's, it's called Denison Avenue, it's this idea of they go to the lake, don't they? There's a point where they go to the lake, and then there's the Parc Rouge, which is, and then the street, that particular area, and going down the Rouge to Il Gus and all that sort of, and Scarborough, you spoke in your presentation about that. So they all have a sense of, a true sense of place, distinct even. So do you feel that these places, these settings, do they in some way carry us forward as well? Do they help the characters move forward or carry forward? Do they help the reader carry themselves through the books, carry forward through the concepts or the themes of grief as well? Or let's move away from that, maybe towards hope, something like that. So the sense of place is strong in all of them. So I was just wondering if you could each speak a little more to the sense of place. We had Bryan, so Tanya?
Sure. For the main character going back home, it's a big deal for her because she's been in the city where she's, she's the only Cree in her community, and then she goes home to her kinship circle, to her aunties, to her mom, to her kokum, who's deceased but still very much alive in her memory and communicating with her. So that's a big, a very important thing of reconciliation for the character to the land where she's from. And this whole thing that runs through the book of, is she a bad Cree because she separated herself from her people? Yes. So she works through that. But then also there's this other aspect where, it's a horror story, and so there's this we to go, this, I don't even know how to describe it, it's just this kind of a goblin, ghost, vampire-ish thing that basically is created through greed, the greed of the oil companies, and then this we to go preys on human weakness. And so it's very much tied to the land and to the horrors done to the land, and the character has to literally grapple with this monster. So it's a story, I would say, that can't take place anywhere else but on the Treaty 8 territory. So it's very much very much about the land.
Which leads me to Morris's book about Fort Detroit, this sort of alternate, I don't know if it's an alternate future or a revisioned, but a lot of what's going on, I couldn't place it in time. It seemed kind of like maybe futuristic, but in a sense, because the title made me think the future, right? So it's talking about the future, but it ends with, it's kind of like, oops, spoiler. there's a lot of mention of moving to the future. As Bryan mentioned in his, it's about the idea of moving through something to something. But, you know, like the way that, like the river and that silver that runs through the girl when she's floating in the river and what we learn what that means, right? The devastation that we've brought on where we live, on our own communities.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think it's an example of hope in spite of the setting.
Yeah.
I mean, it's an industrial wasteland.
I agree. Yeah.
It's an industrial wasteland. There are all kinds of awful things flowing into the river, you know, killing off animals and fish and all kinds of things. And, you know, you have houses, like you say, crumbling into the ground. And yet, at the end of it all, the Tour de Lis, this tower that is sort of the equivalent of the Leaning Tower of Pisa, but they keep blowing it up and knocking it over, and it keeps kind of rising from the ashes. Mm. And I think the characters, in spite of all of this, and it's not a pretty world.
No. But there's beauty in the book.
But there's beauty in the book, and the beauty is in the community and in the bonds that people are able mm-hmm. to create with one another, and the children create with each other, mm-hmm. that they've turned their back on this, and they're down in this ravine surrounded by nature. They've gone back to nature because society is just not for them.
Mm-hmm.
But ultimately, they're all finding a way forward. And all finding a sense of community and, I think, ultimately, optimism.
Mm-hmm. Marie.
So, did you want to say
something? No, I wanted you to speak. Did you find your passage, and did you want to speak to the idea of the
I'm going to move on to the question of place.
Yeah.
The name of the book is Denison Avenue. It is home to Wong Cho-sum and Wong Henry, and the way she moves through her grief is reflecting back on the activities, the intimacy of the activities they would do in their home, whether it's cooking or reading or listening to the radio, preparing foods for community potlucks. There's this beautiful intimacy about their home that transcends in all of the descriptions when the story is about the space, place of Denison Avenue. And then there's the story about Chinatown, which for those of you who've been there, unless you were there in 1965, you would have assumed that that's where Chinatown has always been in Toronto. But in fact, the Wongs emigrated from China to the first Chinatown in Toronto, and then the city of Toronto evicted, this is all in the book, and it's a through line because her husband objected to the eviction, expropriation of their house on Walton Avenue, which is where City Hall, that big City Hall with the curvature, is now. That whole neighborhood was expropriated, and all of those families, which if you know anything about the Exclusion Act, you will know if you were Chinese, you were persona non grata, and to some would say, and the story reveals this to this day, that the anti-Asian hate prevails. As a bottle lady, she's walking around, and pretty well, there's all the characters she meets are kind, and she experiences random acts of kindness, except for one incident, which is quite visceral, and it transports you from the original Chinatown to the new Chinatown, where it's an uglier place, because the original Chinatown was really home for the first generation of Chinese who came to Canada, and then they had to disperse. And even the Chinatown we know now is a less safe place for them at the beginning of their residence there, and as they, as the world of the buildings in that Chinatown change.
Mm-hmm. I'd just like to add a little something.
Sure, go ahead.
So because the book has two very distinct settings, that proves to be very symbolic.
Yes.
In terms of, you know, Fern choosing between
Toronto.
Yeah, basically
and
two
Muskoka.
Different entire lifestyles. And there's very different imagery that's used for both. When describing Toronto, the author says, "The sun crouched low in the sky, winking between buildings and glittering off glass towers." And I found that really beautiful. While earlier she is describing the resort and the more natural way that it is existing. Mm-hmm. And then she also uses the phrase that Fern thought that moving to Toronto was like moving to the moon, mm-hmm. and that when originally moving there, she wished she could play Space Explorer forever. Mm. And I found that to be very descriptive of her character at the time. And through the novel, we sort of see how her perspective changes, and it also just teaches us that it's okay to change.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think we're... how are we doing for time, Ron? We good? I'm not sure where we are on... Oh, it's time for another drawing. This conversation could go on all night. Which, you know, is great. We're going to be doing questions from the audience after we do this next drawing. But, yeah, and I just wanted to say, like, in your book, Elvina, it's almost a sense of displace. It's almost like a displacement in a way. Yeah. Anyway, we're going to be doing the drawing, but that's something to think about.
Yeah, I should get a ticket.
You should get a ticket!
I don't have one, and Maurice doesn't have one.
I felt, okay, here we go. Door prizes, here we go. Oh, you gotta turn it on. You want me to do it?
It's on.
Oh, no, thank you. No, he controls it, right? So get your tickets ready. You got them in front of you there. So the first number is 7414. 7414.
7414? Yes. All right. Woo. We should clap.
You'll give it. Oh, these are.
Those are the ones that could go in the drawing.
In the end. Yeah.
Okay.
7414. Okay. 7435. 7435. There you go. Good. Seven, four, five, six.
7456.
There you go.
All right.
Go to the back. 7423.
7423. Yes.
7423.
7423.
Oh, there you go. You got it. 7420. Oh. Hey, there you go.
All right. 7420.
There you go. Right there. 7429.
7429.
There you go. Good. 7430.
7430. 7430.
Oh, is that Louise? 7443. Oh, there you go. There you go. 7467.
Hey.
7458.
7458.
There you go. Now make sure you hang on to your tickets, because they're going to put all these tickets back in the basket, and we'll do our final draw for the five books signed by the authors. Hang in there.
Okay. All right. So it's questions from the floor time. I think I'm going to take the mic. All right. At this point of the evening, we are going to be taking questions from the floor. Saul, do you have any online questions as well? No. Oh, my goodness. Not yet. Yet. All right. So questions from the floor. This is like you never know what's going to happen. And then after that, we're going to have one last question, and they're going to defend. They have 2 minutes more to defend to defend their novel as the which one the best book to carry us forward, and then you get a chance to vote. And you should all have ballots, so please make sure that you have ballots
They're wonderfully now. It used to be back in the day when we were like all shoved into the tiny Lennoxville library. We would write it on little pieces of paper and stick it in this little basket thing. And now it's just this wonderful graphics that we have. All right, so questions from the audience. Mead, do you have a question? Mead! Can I just say the past 2 years, Mead has provided me with notes just in case I didn't get the chance to read the books. So I'm because you never know. I don't know. Maybe you know what it's like to be an English teacher. I love my job, but it's a lot of reading. So Mead, what is the question that you have? Mead has like 10, so just be prepared. I have to limit him, but here we go.
Okay, one theme I saw running through a number of the books was the struggle between poverty and wealth. And some of them were just so ridiculous. Like in one of them where there was the urban decay tour driving through to look at how horrible that was. And the other one was there was this Bathurst Street list of all the important things for the residents, and none of them had to do with the residents. So in all of your books, did you see any thoughts about the struggle between the ultra-rich and the ordinary lives of everyday people?
That's a great question. Okay, Marie.
So I mentioned when I was talking about the walks Cho Sum would do, how she would experience random acts of kindness, and that could take the shape of her going by a bar in Kensington Market where she had gotten to know the bouncer and he would set the cans out, or she might go behind to a Chinese food restaurant where she had been with her husband earlier and they knew her and they would give her a bag of food. All the random acts of kindness were between people who were in similarly vulnerable positions of class. The one or two most striking examples of the gap between rich and poor was the car that killed Henry Wong. Was a black BMW, the hit and run, and it was described as something that he was the ninth of, I think, 59 that year who had been killed in a hit and run, and the cars were always fancy cars, according to the author. And then the one experience of visceral hate is when she's finally got her courage up to go down an alley where she can see there's cans, and all of a sudden she feels a drop of water on her. And she thinks, that's funny, it's not raining. And one of the owners of a house who was clearly feeling that she was expressing her property ownership and her wealth and her pride, and she's described in a way that makes you think of her as, I guess the colloquial term would be, a Karen, is taking the hose to Cho Sum and trying to get her to leave her property because she is taking cans and bottles without having asked permission. Something Cho Sum never thought, she always asked permission before, but this time she felt safe, and in that one instance, a wealthy woman who was dressed to the nines put a hose on her.
One of the biggest way that theme is shown in the book is through Will. 10 years ago, he was an aspiring artist, but life brought other plans, and he was forced to find a job that would support his family. And that's something that's really hard to comprehend, that some of the things that are so important to our society, that culture, it can be so hard to make a living with. And, you know, through the story, you sort of see Will regain his artistic side. And you know, even if you can't make a living out of it, it's important to do what you're passionate about. So I think that's the main way that the theme was shown in Meet Me at the Lake.
I would like to talk about one sentence in the book. This appears in a story called The Event. And I don't know where Galloway is, but it seems to be very, very, very low on a totem pole. And this is when Lolly and her friend Jolie were, they're maybe about 13, 14. And this one sentence says, "We were the kids of Galloway, and they were anyone who judges for it." And at first, it just seems like any other sentence. And the first independent clause, "We were the kids of Galloway," seems to imply there's a sense of solidarity, sort of identity that you can even be proud of. Like, we're the kids of America, we're the kids of whatever. We're the kids of Galloway. And this, but then we sort of get to see the soft underbelly of their bravado. We get to look beyond the facade, because the next clause is, "And they were anyone who judged us for it." So in contrast to we as a solitary, you know, unit of children, of youngsters, 13, 14 years old, we were the kids of Galloway. They, the people who judge us, they were anyone. And that implication, they're anyone. They don't have to be someone. They can be anyone, anyone at all, judging them, scrutinizing them, criticizing them. So if they are anyone, what does it mean to be the kids of Galloway? They're no ones. And so, despite the first part of the sentence being, "We were the kids of Galloway," right, brave, we're tough, the second part just completely destroys that. "And they were anyone who judges for it." And that sense of these poor kids having that strong front almost, "We're the kids of Galloway." But in actual fact, when you just poke them a little, you can see it's nothing but bravado. It's nothing but a facade. And the fact that they realize that they are so othered and so lonely and so lowly, it's absolutely heartbreaking. They're just kids.
You know, I think the future has some similarities to Denison Avenue, actually, in that, like, there is that stratification between rich and poor. We don't see much in terms of, like, the wealthy, except that this tour bus that comes through and the rich people are sitting in the tour bus watching the poor people. It's kind of like, you know, Lifestyles of the Rich and Shameless that we see on reality TV, but turned around, that the wealthy people are looking at the poor people to kind of gawk at them. I hadn't actually really considered that angle until the question came up, but there is that othering and the fact that when there are acts of kindness amongst the characters, it's people in the same, you know, like, we're all in this together kind of thing. And the rich, the wealthy don't play any role in that, really. They don't help, they don't, when the bus runs over the neighbor's father, it just keeps going and nothing's done about it. And I think it kind of highlights how when you're in that other class, it's easy to, shall we say, I don't know, other the other, like disconnect yourself from those around you.
In Bad Cree, I would say rather than looking at the dichotomy between rich and poor, it's more of an exploration of greed and exploitation. With the theme of looking at what the oil companies have done, coming in and taking the resources from the land, ripping it up, leaving it devastated, not cleaning up their mess, and the people, the Cree people, are left with that, with a permanently altered landscape. And then also the exploitation with the theme of missing and murdered Indigenous women and girls that it's just talked about in passing, and yet there's this thread of grief and horror that runs through the whole community, through the Cree people, that this is part of their generational history, their generational trauma.
Thank you. Thank you all. We have some questions online, so do you want me to read it, Saul? Oh, my. Amelia, is it? Oh, which one? Emily Bowles. So we're going to begin with Emily Bowles. Which book, other than your own, did you enjoy the most and why? That's assuming you read the other books, but yeah. So that's the question. Which book, other than your own, did you enjoy the most and why?
So I'm reading The Future Now. I read Bad Cree and I read Shut Up, You're Pretty. I have not read Meet Me at the Lake because I knew that would be a quick read, but I didn't get to it. And I have to say The Future, the fact that it was originally written in French makes me want to read it in French because the translation is so beautiful. And the story is exquisite. I was saying to Morris, it's Orwellian in its imagery. So The Future would be the book that I really want to read fully, to complete. I'm still reading it.
Okay. Bryan?
I personally have not gotten the chance to read the other books yet, but reading the summaries, they all connect to us in so many ways. And I just, you know, I found myself intrigued by each and every book because of different reasons, and I'm really excited to look into them and read them.
I have a personal policy not to read for fun during a working semester because I'm so overwhelmed at work. So even when Christian, the librarian, asked me, do you want to do Canada Reads this year? And I'm like, oh, you're making me break my policy. So I won't be reading any of the books until summer, unfortunately, because it's just not something that I'm prepared to do. I refuse to start a book and then have to put it down to grade like piles of essays. So it just destroys that momentum for me. And so I'll get back to you, Emily Bowles, in the summer.
Remember what I said about being an English teacher, right? Morris.
Yeah. Well, I think the next on my reading list has got to be Denison Avenue. Although from what I've heard this evening, I think there's going to be at least one or two others that I'm going to be tucking into in the near future. But Denison Avenue is definitely next on my reading list.
Thank you. Tanya?
I have to say the same for me as Morris. I'm very interested in the dual storytelling of how the illustrations and the narrative work together. So I really like to get my hands on Denison Avenue and just see how the two work together in that way. And I'm also really interested in architecture and in location, dislocation. That book is definitely very compelling, but I understand it's hard to get a copy.
You know where I live.
Tanya, maybe you'll win all five books tonight.
Ooh,
signed by the author.
Wonderful.
That'd be wonderful. Remember, that is the grand prize. Two different, 10 books total, five and five. So we have another question online, and then I'm going to move into the audience a bit. So this is Amelia Amelia. So a theme that I've heard throughout the presentations is destigmatization, whether it be about the novel's characters, communities, settings, or even the genre of the novel itself. How does this specific theme allow for your presented novel to carry us forward as society beyond the pages of the book? Well, you know, that's the question that we're going to be asking in a few minutes. So we'll come back to that question. That's an amazing question. But that is our basically the two-minute roundup question is that how does a specific theme allow for your presented novel to carry us forward as a society beyond the pages of the book? So do we have any other questions from our audience or live audience? Yes? Just let the note, we have had 42 people online plus the people here in the room tonight. So that is an amazing turnout for Canada Reads. Here you go. Your name?
Thank you very much. My question is for Bryan, but feel free anyone to add to it. You mentioned in the beginning that Meet Me at the Lake is the first book in its genre to be chosen for Canada Reads. I was wondering what you think about the genre and if you think it's undervalued or overlooked in literature.
I was definitely surprised to hear that it was the first time that a romance book was on Canada Reads, and I do feel that oftentimes it's a genre that's overlooked for its value, even if it can be just a book that you read for fun to pass the time. They're real life stories, and they're the stories that can connect to us the most because they're stories about real people living normal lives and on a day-to-day basis. And they all these books have a value to them, and I definitely feel that society shouldn't necessarily think of them as just like a fluffy read is a term that is used oftentimes. So, yeah.
Okay, thank you, Bryan. Are there any other questions? Anyone? Ooh, very quiet. Oh yes, yeah.
I'm wondering if you felt a sense of symbolism in all the different places that were presented in the book, like the ravine where the kids were, to me was very protective. The outer area from the ravine, once they got to the river, was so unknown and scary because of the pollution. Even the street with the green house, the yellow house, it was so kind of predictable and helpful for Gloria, but it was very, we didn't get much more out of it than the fact that they were almost copycat houses. Yet in the ravine, the kids were just wonderful how they created their environment. They depended on each other, so the ravine was just, to me, the most wonderful place. I wondered if you saw symbolism in all those places that were presented. Even the raft. The raft is not a place, but the building of the raft, the kids just did it, and they were so hopeful and just going out to a place that could have like destroyed them immediately. So there were many, there's a lot of symbolism in her book.
There is certainly a lot of symbolism in terms of like, there's the optimism of kids that kind of shines through in this, that these children have all been through horrific, you know, they're not there for nothing. They've been through horrific things. They've lost parents or they've been abandoned, and yet they still look to the kids around them, and there's this still this sense of wonder about the whole thing. And it seems like as adults we kind of tend to lose that, and I think when we lose that we lose a bit of that purely human essence. So yeah.
Thanks, Carol. Okay, any other questions? Yes, oh, Mead, okay. Mead wants to know if anybody else has a question. All right, Massimo, we'll go Massimo, then Mead, and we'll wrap up with Mead, and then we're gonna have our final questions and our vote. And I just wanna remind you, there's tons of food. Like, feel free, and presenters, you know, go get yourself a nosh at some point. It's, you know, really worth it. Okay, so Massimo.
Yeah, thanks for letting me go again. This time I'd have a question for Elvina. I was wondering I didn't really get the link between, I haven't read the book, sorry, but I didn't really get the link between the description and the title. So I was wondering if you could help me with that. Thank you.
She has that tabbed.
Does. It's actually a title of one of the stories, right, Elvina?
It's a title of the stories. It's also mentioned elsewhere. And, you know, I don't need a tab for it, actually. It's one of these things where, well, actually, Tia Mutunji, in her acknowledgments, also mentioned where she got the title from. and it's actually someone, I believe another waitress colleague, friend, who, you know, when she's apparently whining about the difficulty of getting the title of the book, say to the effect, shut up, you're pretty. And it's in a number of the stories in the text. And basically, Lolly's pretty. And the title seems to, on the one hand, suggest that, you know, being pretty is an asset, right? And therefore, you shouldn't have anything to complain about because you have that one asset over others. You have that extra edge. But that's actually a downside to being pretty. And it's not the from that chapter that has that name, but a different chapter, she also sort of suggests that there are, you know, negative implications or negative consequences of being pretty. You go through life being touched, you go through life being looked at, you go through life with an uncle commenting on your breasts or your brother's friend giving you a condom for your birthday, then denying it. You go through life being called a cunt on, oops, sorry, no kids here, okay. Sorry about that, on public transportation. You go through life being followed at midnight, you go through life being told you're pretty, you're so fucking pretty. I'm double checking to make sure no kids run in. It gets complicated. So it's, you know, there are also the negative sides of being pretty. But on the other hand too, being told shut up, you're pretty, it sort of diminishes a person. It reduces that person to nothing but their physical appearance, that because you're pretty, therefore you shouldn't complain, when in fact that's not the truth, right? Just because you happen to have that one perhaps positive quality, which in fact she reveals to not be a positive quality, doesn't mean that you have no right to be able to air your grievances, to be able to feel the things that you do, to feel the hurt that you do. And so I think that the title, it's only four words, but complexly points to the difficulty of being a woman and how it's so easy to be put down, to be diminished, and basically to lose her voice. And at one point when she's young, she literally kind of loses her voice. She just stops talking. When she loses a friend.
Okay. Thank you. Me, last question, and we're going to do our wrap-up.
Very quick, Tanya. I really remember the scene where Mackenzie was kneading the dough, and it made her slow down and think and take time, and I identified with Mackenzie very much there. And I also liked the way the auntie said, don't call me, it's bingo night, and stuff like that. And That bad Cree really made me see Indigenous people in that context as being just like us. And so, do you relate to that? And how did you identify with the with Mackenzie and the others?
Yeah, I listened to quite a few interviews with Jessica Johns as I was preparing for tonight, and that's one thing that she really emphasizes, that she wanted to write about her aunties. She wanted to write about her what she calls her kinship circle. And I find her very generous as a writer in bringing us into her community and giving us that insider view of how that world works. And I really appreciate that about the book.
Okay, so we're at the 2-minute summary from each presenter. We started with Tanya and ended with Marie. Now we're going to start with Marie and come all the way back to Tanya. So. It's basically the question that was online that I read from Amelia, but I have also the, Ron gave me a version of it as well. So it says, tell the audience why you think your book is the best book to reflect the theme of Canada Reads this year, the one book to carry us forward. So, Marie.
This is a love story with no sex. And it is a tale of moving through loss and grief with great dignity and beauty, and I'm going to read, and it might take me more than a minute, so you'll have to cut me off.
I think so. Go ahead.
Cho Sum is sitting beside Henry in the hospital as he is dying. And this is the book. You had one of the beds by the window and the view looked towards Chinatown. It was as if you each wanted to see each other one last time. The sky was clear. It was a bright blue, like the color of a blue jay, as you would say. You've lost weight since you came. Your cheeks no longer rosy, your hair even more disheveled, bruises and cuts still visible. But if you woke up now, I know you would say, "No hornyor, I'm so hungry." And you would ask for fancy homsui goi farsang or maybe antat. I looked to the foot of your bed where a beam of sunlight shone. And in that beam of sunlight, I could see the dust motes floating ever so slightly. The invisible made visible just right then. All the things we want to say remain left unsaid. We were never one with words. I take your left hand and clasp it. I then hold it with both of mine. Your hand still rough to the touch from decades of labor, fingertips stained yellow from the years of smoking. I take a deep breath. In that moment, I realized I had not held your hand since we had our portrait taken by your friend David Wong. You used to talk about his studio. Many of your friends and colleagues would get him to take their portrait so they could send those photos back home along with their letters and the money they earned to let their families know they were okay.
That's it. That's your time.
Bryan, 2 minutes. Why is this the book to carry us forward?
So, yes, Meet Me at the Lake is a romance novel, and yes, you can probably guess how it ends. But I truly believe it's just as worthy as being voted the one book to carry us forward as any of the other books presented here tonight. The way I view the prompt, a book to carry us forward, comes through all the meanings that can be extracted from the novel. One of the main reasons this book can collectively carry us forward is because so many people can connect to it in one way or another. From the grief to choosing your life path, everyone has been or will go through these challenges in their lives. Each and every person has their own journey and grows up to be a different person they were before. Fern's character development shows us that it's okay to dream, but it's also okay to change your dream. It's okay to change your views on something or someone. It shows the importance of maintaining good friendships to help support you through harder times and the importance of acceptance. When reading Meet Me at the Lake, the reader will observe the value of the characters as witnessed through the themes that Fortune explores. An all-time favorite quote from the self-published author Abby Emmons says, "A story isn't about what happens, it's about how what happens affects the characters." And while that's true for most stories, or at least it should be, it's especially important in this one. All these characters continuously face struggles of their own, and that's where all the meaning can be pulled. Once you've read this book, you'll see just how powerful this summer read can be. That's how Meet Me at the Lake can carry us forward.
Thank you. Well done. Elvina.
Well, to me, the phrase carry forward, on the one hand, implies some sort of progress, right? Some sort of advancement to go forward. But at the same time, it also points to some sort of weight and burden, some responsibility that has to be shouldered. And I think that Shut Up, You're Pretty, ostensibly, it's a narrative about a young girl trying to find herself, trying to look into self and have a certain level of introspection. At the same time, while she's coping with a very hostile world on an everyday basis. And I think that narrative is a sort of microcosm for what we as Canadians should always be doing, that we should always be questioning who we are, what we are, basically our identity, and who we want to be, while at the same time, we should be examining the world around us. Is this What sort of world is this? Is this the world that we want? What are the values, and are these values ours? And if not, what can we do about it? So the continuous process of observation and contemplation is necessary for us as Canadians to carry forward, to carry us as Canadians forward, so that we can navigate through these very dark times in this very dark world while being at ease with our conscience, being clear about who we are, while still also being able to hold our heads up high. And so I think it's a small book, it's a narrative about a very young girl, but it's reflective of our society and our culture and our nation at large.
Thank you. Yes. Morris.
Yes. I just wanted to make a comment before I do this is, in the world of literature and publishing, that there's a tendency to minimize certain genres, like, oh, it's a romance novel, it's a crime novel, it's whatever. And I think the books tonight have shown that literature can be found in many different places, and that you shouldn't turn your nose up at something just because it's maybe a style you haven't written or read before. The future wasn't a style of novel that I typically read, but it's exactly that, it's the future. It paints a picture that taps into our current existential angst. If you're not worried about the future these days, you're not paying attention. It offers in all of that hints of optimism of what could be. Society might collapse, but community will endure. And with it, humanity in all of its messy, complicated glory. So, thank you.
Thank you, Morris. Tanya.
Bad Cree is a book to carry us forward. It's tense, but tender and terrifying. It's a horror mystery that reflects the evil in our world, but the book also has a softer, more vulnerable side. It shows the generational trauma of the Cree people in their memories, in their bodies, in their land, residential schools, missing and murdered Indigenous women and girls. The history of the Cree is one of horror. But it doesn't end there. Not everything that's passed down is bad. In addition to the generational trauma, Bad Cree also shows the generational magic. It remembers the joy and the beauty that is passed down to us by those who've gone before. And to illustrate this point, I wanted to read you an excerpt from the last pages of the book. Bad isn't something you can run from, because it's not a thing that can be held. It's a steady beating, like a heart or a drum, a sound that lives in the body and grows down into the ground. That's the best and worst thing about being connected to everything. You are a part of it all, but you can't choose what gets sent out into the world or what can find you. I still hold a piece of the bad inside me. I used to think enough love was supposed to wipe all the bad clean, but I don't think that's true anymore. The truth is, I am brimming with love, pouring from the tip of Kokum's finger, Auntie Verna's eyes, Mum's hands. But there will always be bad living alongside it, etched under my skin. Living with bad doesn't make me bad, though. It's just there, like everything else. This love that Jennifer Johns writes about in Bad Cree is what gives us hope, what carries us forward, love, forgiveness, reconciliation.
And that's it. That is, now it's time for you to vote. And also to get some food. Let's go. Please, there's so much. you vote, and then they're going to get picked up by the library volunteers. So please vote for which book you feel carries us forward.
this working? Ah, thank you. I'd like to ask all our presenters back up on the stage. We're going to have, we're going to announce our victory book, I guess. I don't know how else to say it. The one that received the most votes this evening. I'm missing Tanya. 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 Okay. All right. Do you want to do the grand prizes first, Ron, or do you want to do the whatever? We'll keep you in suspenders. Okay.
So just to show you, these are all the tickets we drew earlier. I'm going to put them back inside for the final grand prize, which, as you know, is 5 books signed by the authors. So, let's mix them up a little bit. And the first person who wins 5 books is number 7457.
7457. Hey, woo! Go collect your grand prize. It's one copy of each of the books presented this evening, signed by the author. Thanks to CBC.
And the second set of 5 books goes to 7463.
7463. Linda, woo! Book club represent. Okay. Thank you, Ron. Thank you, everyone. So it is. Yeah. So
we've come to the end. We've come to the end once again. I hope you've had a really good time. I really enjoyed the discussion this evening. Thank you to all of you, very, very much. So, apparently, according to Lennox, Canada Reads and So Does Lennoxville, the book which is the one to carry us forward, is Denison Avenue. All right, once again, there might be some food to take with you, and if you feel so generous as to contribute to the library, as you know, that, as Christian mentioned, you know, we run on volunteers and the money given to us and generous donations. You can adopt a book as well. There's an Adopt a Book, the program. There's lots of programs given on Saturdays for kids. It's a really vibrant part of the community now. I want to thank you all, Marie, Bryan, Elvina, Morris, Tanya. I know all of you in some way. I've just enjoyed the evening so much. I just want to say Bryan is one of the youngest people to defend a book for Canada Reads, so thank you. And if you feel so inclined, you might want to go pick up The Peacekeeper's Daughter, and you might want to check out Morris's mysteries set in the Granby and Sutton area. And maybe one day we'll have Bryan up there. And Elvina, wow, I'd really love to sit in one of your classes sometime and hear what you have to say at Champlain. And Marie, congratulations. You defended your book so, so well.
Thank you for inviting me, and thank you for everyone for coming. But to the people on this panel, it's been a real privilege. I really enjoyed myself. Thank you.
Thank you. I couldn't have said it better myself, so we're just going to leave it at that. Thank you, and a safe drive. Christian, final words? Help if I turn the mic on. No.
Well, I'll just second what Stephanie said. Thank you all so much for coming. Thank you for being part of our event. And I didn't want the night to end without giving a special thanks to the Steve Elkis Funeral Home and the Honorable Marie-Claude Bibeau, who funded most of our event, also the Papeterie Lennoxville that printed our beautiful posters. And thank you guys all for being here. Thank you to our presenters, and we'll see you next year.